We left the last episode with Tif's awesome backflips on Prickly Pear Key in Anguilla. The weather was calm and nobody was around, so we stayed the night at Prickly Pear with the hopes of doing a little wing foiling in the protected waters inside the reef. My foiling is definitely not improving as fast as Tif's backflips.
Is to get it up on foil. Not easy. But we're gonna keep trying till we get it.
What do you like, pump it?
Pump it!
One man.
Whoa!
Versus the world.
Action shot. Right here.
Whoa!
Oh, he's up. Oh!
There he is, he's up.
We got a couple boat projects done and we're really enjoying this pretty remote anchorage, but the wind was looking good for a quick sail back to the main island of Anguilla, and we definitely wanted to check out a couple of cool bays we were told about. So we raised the anchor and hoisted the sails. The sails we love to see flying the most are our screechers. As you may have seen in a previous episode, we have two light wind screechers, almond sails calls, an upwind and downwind code zero. We've had Little Bird almost a full season now, and we really haven't felt the need to change or add much to the sail config. We did make one smallish change to the controls though. We converted our screecher halyard from a 2-to-1 purchase to something called a halyard lock. Many catamarans have a 2-to-1 halyard for the furling screechers or code zero. The reason is you really need a tight luff tension to properly furl these big sails on continuous line furlers. You also need to distribute the load over a couple points on the masthead given the stresses involved in these big sails. The problem often seen with 2-to-1 halyards like this is all the extra line you need to deal with. What happens is twist is introduced into the line inside the mast each time you raise and lower the sails. And because we have two screechers and a spinnaker to choose from, we do switch these sails pretty often. No matter how careful we are with removing the twist from the line, we would start to have 5 to 10 tight twists collect at the masthead when the sail is raised. This causes two really bad things. The first is chafe of the halyard. You could really chafe through and the whole halyard can come down. And then the twist can actually lock together and make it hard or even impossible to lower the sail if you needed to lower it quickly. We've used 2-to-1 halyards many times and the twist has always been an issue you could generally deal with. For some reason on Little Bird, it proved especially hard. We actually removed the halyard 5 or 6 times with a mousing line and fully removed the twist, but it kept being an issue. Maybe it's the length of the line, you know, the mast is almost 70 feet tall, or maybe it's the type of line that we're using, but we've been contemplating several solutions. An additional swivel at the masthead, different cordage, but we kept coming back to what's used on many racing boats, a halyard lock. The halyard lock has many advantages. First, it gets rid of all the extra halyard line. Second, it gets rid of all of the mast compression that line introduces into the mast. And third, it preserves the load distribution points at the masthead. The 2-to-1 halyard is replaced by a relatively thin spectre line that really only has to be strong enough to pull the sail up and down. When the head of the sail gets to full hoist, a small collar connects to a receiver at the masthead. With the motion similar to the click of a ballpoint pen, you click the halyard lock together. Then we tension our existing 2-to-1 tack at the bowsprit. That downward tension prevents the halyard lock from unclicking and also gives us that luff tension needed to furl and unfurl the sail. When you want to lower the sail, you simply release the tack pressure and then you jerk the smaller halyard up and down. It releases like that same ballpoint pen and you lower the sail. So far, it has been a huge improvement.
After this long, stressful day, you think you quite need a beverage.
On a typical night like this, we like to play some Uno, have a couple beverages,
talk about how silly our children are.
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
Yow!
Bros for life.
I forget, how do you play Uno?
Stopped over from Crocus Bay on Anguilla. It's a little island out here. Not much protection, but a little beach bar. Very cool.
One of my absolute favorite spots so far on this whole trip actually was this place called Little Bay. And we first landed in Croaks Bay, which is right next to it, and we didn't realize how close we were to Little Bay. And I happened to paddle over there, and these amazing caves were along these cliffs, a big rock to jump off of. So everybody had a really good time checking that out. Turns out we had an amazing time also towing the kids in the back of the dinghy with the wing foils. So they got a chance to do that.
What is that, George?
It's the way to starve off the scurvy.
We decided the next day to head over to Rendezvous Bay, which was supposed to be a really good spot to anchor and do some more water sports. But it turns out COVID put the kibosh on that. We weren't able to stay. So after we had anchored, we found out we had to head out. We headed on out over to Tintamar, which is a little bay or a little island actually off the coast of Saint Martin. So we made our way over to there and anchored overnight, and it was a beautiful spot. I did a few laps around the boat this morning. There were turtles and rays and a beautiful beach. The really cool thing is the kids got to go explore the island, and they spent a couple hours hiking around and chilling on the beach at Tintamar.
Tintamar was another one of those surprising stops. We didn't know a lot about it and really only ended up there because we got kicked out of Rendezvous Bay. We've been lucky, and this has been a consistent theme of our exploring this season. Sometimes events just come together and work out. Tintamar is less than 200 acres and has no inhabitants. It's actually protected as a nature reserve as part of French Saint Martin and was a perfect spot to enjoy our time with the kids and relax. We only had a few days left with the boys before we needed to head back towards the main island of Saint Martin and exchange crews for our upcoming 1,200-mile passage to Florida. So we slowly made our way back around the south side of St. Martin into the anchorage at the cool little town of Grand Case. The French side of St. Martin is really different from the Dutch side, much more laid back. It was a fun place to walk around, get a bite to eat, and for Tif and Ava to do a little shopping. I can't say us boys were as involved in that. Everyone was in full relax mode, and I could tell some little bird dance party energy was building ahead of the kids' departure back to the real world.
What are you doing, big man?
Checking stuff out, making sure it works for the big crossing we got coming up, heading up to the Bahamas.
You know what, one thing we will have? Bagels.
And just like that, it was time to say goodbye to the kids. It was super fun to have their crazy energy on board. The boys had grown up sailing in San Francisco Bay, Santa Cruz, and down in Mexico, but it was fun to have them on board as the adults they've become. Megan and Pete were waiting for us in Marigot Bay, and it was great to have a goodbye and welcome dinner all together before the kids left for the airport the next morning.
Heading to the airport in a few minutes.
Love you guys. Safe travels.
We took the next day for our new crew to get acclimated to the boat and get ready for our passage. But more on that in the next episode.
I'm so happy to be here.
Thanks for having us.
Yay.